بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد. We continue إن شاء الله the book of جنازة or الجنائز. And بعد, you know, the chapter that we've been studying, الحمد لله رب العالمين, starting from the تجهيز الجنازة, preparing the جنازة, and then the we were talking about the ghusl, the taghsil al-mayyit, the washing of the dead body, and the all the etiquette and the wajibat and the ahkam related to it. And then we passed to at-takfinu, the way to wrap the body, to cover the body and everything. This chapter is going to be talking about, insha'Allah, the salat, salatul janaza. يقول المصنف رحمه الله تعالى فصل السنة أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره وعند وسطها السنة أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره وعند وسطها. Now after the body was washed, was covered, you know, with the kafan, and then the salat is going to be observed and offered. So remember in the beginning, al-musannif rahimahullah said in the beginning, قال in the beginning of the book, if you go back to see that he already talked about the salat. That's why in the beginning of this chapter he didn't mention it. Just if you قال كتاب الجنائز in the beginning of the book قال تسن عيادة المريض وتذكير وإذا نزل به الموت then go then قال the second the first after the first paragraph of the second one قال غسل الميت وتكفينه والصلاة عليه ودفنه فرض كفاية. So from the beginning he gives the introduction that the washing of the dead person, the takfin, to cover him, and to do the whole the shrine, the shroud, and to cover him. قال والصلاة عليه والصلاة عليه, and to pray, observe the prayer and pray صلاة الجنازة. ودفنه, and to bury him, فرض كفاية. So that's the beginning. Then he started with the ghusl, how to do the ghusl, and then the takfin. This is what we have finished, and then the salah. So that's why here in the beginning he didn't start with what we said. قال السنة أن يقام أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره. So here when he started, we were talking about the salah. So he didn't repeat the same sentence because he started it from the beginning of the book. So which if we going to, you know, go back to that sentence and resume exactly from where we stopped. So he said الصلاة عليه فرض كفاية. الصلاة عليه فرض كفاية. So someone will ask you, what is the ruling of صلاة الجنازة? The ruling of صلاة الجنازة is فرض كفاية. Is فرض كفاية is a collective obligation. Collective obligation, and we know the meaning, the difference between فرض عين و فرض كفاية. فرض كفاية, collective obligation, which is means one group of the community will fulfill this obligation. Therefore, it will be non-obligatory or on the others. And if none of the community will fulfill this task, so the whole community will be in sin. فقال فرض كفاية. So it's a must for someone who passed away, a Muslim, that there will be a group who will be offering and observing the prayer of janazah. Even at least one, at least one, but one, this is in case if there's nobody. We'll talk about it, inshallah ta'ala. Now, if the dead body is put in front of the imam, so here when he said, قال السنة أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره وعند وسطها. So it's like the author starting with like a situation here. The situation, we have the dead body facing in the, toward the Qibla, and then the Imam stand in front of the dead body. So the dead body between the Imam and the Qibla. And then here he specified. So قال السنة, to the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this is the first sunnah that we're going to say. So قال السنة هي دي سي قال أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره وعند وسطها. So the way how to stand in front of the dead body for the Imam when he's going to start the prayer, we have in the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, for the man he stand toward the chest, and the other opinion toward the head, and for the woman he stand in her middle. He stand in her middle. That's why قال السنة, the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the standing of the Imam in front of the dead body will be by the side of the chest or the head, as the opinion of the other scholars. وعند وسطها, and if is, and if the dead person is a woman, the standing of the Imam should be the sunnah, following the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, to be in the middle of the woman. قال فنقول الصلاة على الميت فرض كفاية, as we mentioned, that's the order of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فيستحب على هذا أن يقوم الإمام عند صدر الرجل وعند وسط المرأة. So this is recommended, is not an obligation. When we say it's not an obligation, if the one who going to lead the prayer of janazah will stand in front of the dead body, man or woman, at any position, that is accepted. But when someone say, what is the etiquette, what is the sunnah? The sunnah is to stand for the man by his chest and for the woman by in her middle, in the middle of her body. And he's saying, you know, the strongest opinion here, when we say what is the strongest opinion in this recommendation in the sunnah, it is for the man to stand by his head, for the man to stand by his head, not specifically by his chest. And this is what been reported in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in hadith عند أحمد, أخرجه أحمد وأبو داود والترمذي وابن ماجة عن أنس ابن مالك. And the Tirmidhi, he said, هذا حديث حسن. So the strongest opinion in standing by the in front of the dead body when his man is by his head. The second opinion is by his chest, so in his upper side. وعند وسطها, أي وسط المرأة, وسط المرأة, and the middle, he stood in the middle of the body, standing before, in front of the middle of the body of the woman, as in the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, قال, is being narrated, قام على امرأة ماتت في نفاسها عند وسطها. A woman, she died while she was delivering a baby. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in her janazah stand at the middle of her body, and the middle of the body. Many of the scholars, they were trying to elaborate on the wisdom of that. But really, we follow the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. As we said, it's not an obligation. So if someone will stand by the legs, the salat is accepted and it will not void the prayer. But what is the Sunnah? This is the Sunnah. Some of the scholars, maybe which one that will be the most less adequate to mention it, because some of the saying, at least we'll mention one of the wisdom. One of the wisdom they said is the sutra. Because subhanAllah, the believers is observe the modesty and the shyness and protecting the woman alive and dead. Therefore, when the Imam will stand in the middle, he will try to cover the most of the body of the woman, and whoever will be praying, then we're praying, focusing on the prayer, and that will be like how to honor the woman, to try to cover her. So he'll cover her with being in the middle, and so everybody will be like he's kind of screening the body of the woman. And that's one of the wisdom, but there is no something specific mentioned in the Sunnah, but that's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. قال أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره. أن يقوم الإمام. أن يقوم is to stand. Therefore, we understand that the prayer is the prayer starting with the standing. So the standing here is a pillar in the prayer of al-janazah. And it is as the other prayers. قال وقد جرت عادة كثير من الناس اليوم أن يقوم مع الإمام الذين قربوا الجنازة إلى الإمام. There's some of the habit that the Ash-Sharihi mentioned. People, when they've been carrying the janazah, as soon as they put the body, they stand next to the Imam. He said, no, the Imam is the one who has to be leading. So anyone has to come behind him. You know, that's how the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, unless the place is very tight or there's no space there, you know, to be on his right and his left, if it's not possible. But the Imam is to be in the front, and he's the one who will be facing the body. Qala, one of the observation that Ash-Sharihu here he's mentioning, قال لا يشترط أن يكون رأس الميت عن يمين الإمام. It's not an obligation or a condition for the head of the dead person to be on the right of the Imam. He can be on the left, on the right. It's either. So there is no specification if they put lay down the body, and when the Imam is standing and the head of the dead person is on his left, he say, no, you have to turn and you need to be on my right. There is no, I mean, someone should not go in such detail and excessive, because it's nothing mentioned in the Sunnah. So there is no condition for such a thing. Whatever the head will be, that's where the Imam, he will be standing. قال فيجوز أن يكون عن يسار الإمام ويمينه. This is opposing to what some people they believe. قال ثم, so السنة أن يقوم الإمام عند صدره وعند وسطها ويكبر أربعة قال ويكبر أربعة, he make four takbirat. Here at takbirat, according to the scholars, are arkan. Those are pillars. Why? Because the takbira is like replacing a rak'ah. The takbira is like replacing a rak'ah in al janazah. So in salat al janazah, there is no ruku', there is no sujood, there is no tashahud. So the takbira is bimathabati rak'ah. So when we say Allahu Akbar, so the second Allahu Akbar, like, you know, this is the second, is like the second rak'ah. So the takbirat are pillars. The takbirat are pillars. When the takbirat, the saying of Allahu Akbar in the prayer, only takbirat al-ihram is a pillar. Only takbirat al-ihram is a pillar. The rest of the takbirat, some according to the scholar what is wajib, and other one are sunnah. According to the Imam Ahmad, takbiratul intiqali wajib, to say the takbira from position to position is required and wajib. But the only takbira that is pillar in the salat, in the daily salat, is takbiratul ihram. For salatul janazah, the four takbirat are pillars. The four takbirat are pillars. Qala, that's why وَيُكَبِّرَ أَرْبَعًا. At every takbira, he going to do a dhikr, and this is how you know what are the dhikr. فيقول ويكبر أربعة يقرأ في الأولى بعد التعوذ الفاتحة. يقرأ في الأولى بعد التعوذ الفاتحة. So after the first takbira, after saying التعوذ, which is أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, he recite the Fatiha. And التعوذ is what, you know, it's the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as he taught us. And also the evidence of that is the ayah in Surah Al-Nahl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قال فإذا قرأت القرآن فاستعد بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. When you're going to read the Quran, say, I seek refuge with Allah from the outcast and cursed shaytan. So, التعوذ, so the beginning, so Allahu Akbar, then someone will make the ta'awud, then he recites Surah Al-Fatiha. And when you see as he's wording here, there's no dua al-istiftah. There's no the dua al-istiftah, which is the sunnah, the dua that we say before the recitation of the Fatiha. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika wa tabara ismuka وتعالى جدك ولا إله غيرك. That's the dua of the istiftah. There's other dua that as we study them and you know, but this dua is a sunnah also, is a sunnah. But saying it, it is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In Salatul Janazah, one of the spirit in Salatul Janazah to be light, very light prayer. Very light prayer because it's the gathering of the people to offer the prayer. The main and the core part of the Janazah is the dua. And then two, because you have in the spirit of the Janazah is to hurry and to need to be fast. Because the honoring of a dead body is to bury the dead body. So it is in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the recommendation to make it fast. Fast in the convenient and adequate way, not fast like to rush and to then to neglect many of the etiquette or many of the pillars, etc. But when we saying so, a spirit is to have the janazah been done, you know, as fast, you know, possible in the adequate way, because the honoring of a dead person is to have this amana and to fulfill the trust that someone, that the dead person has toward his people is to, and toward the Muslim is to put him in the grave. فقال هنا therefore salat the dua al istiftah it will not be you know as in the spirit so say make a ta'awud then the fatiha and there's no even surah even though some of the scholars they say if someone will recite the dua the supplication of the opening of the prayer there's no objection but we're saying there is no in the sunnah I mean the apparent sunnah how it's been narrated that there's dua the istiftah. قال وقوله بعد التعود الفاتحة الفاتحة أفادنا رحمه الله أن الفاتحة لا بد منها وهو كذلك. So this is when he said الفاتحة. الفاتحة so is an obligation in صلاة الجنازة. And the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. No salat, which means salat is void for the one who does not recite the Fatiha, the Fatiha al-Kitab. And we studied that in the book of the prayer. Some of the scholar also, they saying it's a pillar. But the list to say about the Fatiha is an obligation, is a wajib, is a wajib. And because the difference, as you know, between al-wajibu wal-ruknu, al-fardu, the difference is when someone will not do the wajib, he can, you know, patch it and correct it with sujood sahw. But if he'll not do the pillar, then he has to repeat the whole rak'ah. So here it is an obligation. In Salatul Janazah, Al-Fatiha is an obligation. قال وصلاة الجنازة صلاة. So because it's salat, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he addressed to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ولا تصلي على أحد منهم مات أبدا. Do not pray on anyone of them who passed away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here talking about the hypocrite who they were totally and completely disbeliever, but they were shown the Islam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to not pray on them because they are not Muslim, they are not believers. قال ولا تصلي. Therefore Allah called the Salat al-Janazah Salat, and therefore here based on it is Salat, then the Fatiha is an obligation in it. قال بعد ذلك ويصلي على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ويصلي على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الثانية كالتشهد. And then الثانية here is the second تكبيرة. In the second تكبيرة, so we say الله أكبر أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, and then بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, and he recites سورة الفاتحة. After that he will say again الله أكبر, and then the الله أكبر is loud, the recitation is all quiet. And so the second one he say الله أكبر, and he will make the salat on the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The question, how can we offer the salat? What is the statement here or the kayfiyya, how the salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be offered. So he told us, he answered the question, qala kattashahudi. Kattashahudi is like the prayer that you do, the salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you do in the tashahud of the salat. Which is Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ibrahim fi al-alamin innaka Hamidul Majid aw ala Ibrahim innaka Hamidul Majid with different narration wa barik ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidul Majid aw the other narration fi al-alamin innaka Hamidul Majid. And for someone to say Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima, that's also enough. That's also is enough. Because that also called as-salatu ala Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As he qala wa in iqtasara ala qawli Allahumma salli ala Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is enough. But here he gives us kayfiyya, his way how to do it. Qal, ويصلي على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الثانية كالتشهدي كالتشهدي to instruct us the way how to make the تشهد ويدعو في الثالثة فيقول ويدعو في الثالثة ويقول أي in the third takbira he will say the dua that been, reported on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, reported and narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have said it. And if someone doesn't know that dua, he will say any dua. So it's not an obligation to say the dua that been narrated or known in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But to know it, that's jami' dua. That's the most comprehensive of the supplication for a dead person as been said by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فيقول اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا إنك تعلم منقلبنا ومثوانا. فيقول so the دعاء اللهم اغفر أو oh الله forgive الله forgive المغفرة تأتي من الستر الستر المغفرة is to cover المغفرة is to cover and here قال مثل المغفر المغفر is the helmet or the that they put to cover it, the soldiers they put to cover their head so to protect it and shield themselves. So the al-maghfira here is to cover those sins and their effect. قال فستر الذنب مع التجاوز عنه. So to cover is like it doesn't exist. To cover it and تجاوز عنه is to ignore it, neglect it. It's like it didn't happen. قال وهي مأخوذة من المغفر الذي يغطى به الرأس. So قال لحينا وميتنا then he said قال فيقول اللهم اغفر لحينا و الله forgive و الله cover those sins and expiate them and shield us from them. That's وقاية ومغفرة وقاية ستر ووقاية. So that's to cover and to shield and to protect us from the sins. قال اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا لحينا نحن المسلمين. So the one who is making dua is a Muslim. To have, oh Allah forgive to everyone alive among us. وميتنا and to everyone who passed away. واضح. And the same thing قال وشاهدنا وغائبنا and everyone witnessing with us. And everyone who is not with us. And almost the same. So it's like anyone who is not with us, alive or dead. وَصَغِيرِنَا وَكَبِيرِنَا and the youngest among us and the oldest among us. وَذَكَرِنَا وَأُنْثَانَا and our male and our and females, all of them. So it's like this dua encompass the whole, all the believers, you know, young and old, man and woman, you know, alive and dead, present or absent, all of them. So this is dua shamil, mashallah. Allahumma ighfir li hayyina wa mayyitina wa shahidina wa ghaibina wa saghirina wa kabirina wa dhakarina wa unthana. Innaka ta'lamu munqalabana, innaka ta'lamu munqalabana wa mathwana. Innaka ta'lamu munqalabana wa mathwana. Before that, he said, you know, this type of ad'iyah, the question we said, the janazah, the prayer need to be kind of fast. Why? Because that's the spirit of the janazah. But here, someone, you know, take the dua and make long dua. The heart of the janazah is the dua. The heart of the janazah is the dua. And by someone, the more he's saying the dua, the more he going to remember things that he will say it in benefit for the one who passed away. And here, al-Sharh give us examples. Give us examples. For example, say, oh Allah, forgive my sins. But you can say, oh Allah, forgive my sins, the one I know and the one I do not know, the tiniest among them and the biggest. So the more someone he's going into details, the more he has more folks, the more he's mentioning things that he could not have or he will be omitting to mention. Because one of the things, I mean, if you don't ask, you will not get. If you don't ask Allah to forgive you, then Allah will not forgive you. So there are sins, someone, if he will, you know, try to make his dua as more exhaustive as possible and more details, that will be anfa'u, will be more beneficial. As he mentioned here, hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is the sunnah of the Prophet, قال اللهم اغفر لي ذنبي كله دقه وجله سره وعلانيته وأوله وآخره. Oh Allah, forgive all my sins, the tiniest among them and the biggest, and the one done openly and the one done secretly, and the first sin ever made and the last sin. اللهم اغفر لي ما قدمت وما أخرت وما أسررت وما أعلنت وما أنت أعلم به مني. All what I have done and all that you know that I do not know that I have done. Yeah. So all of that is type of the ad'iya that is in the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as in this dua, which is, this is a spirit of the ad'iya that someone will, should learn. When he said, قال إنك تعلم منقلبنا ومثوانا, هذا تعليل ما سبق, to show that we need ya Allah, we ask your forgiveness for all of that, because you know how we're going to end. تعلم منقلبنا ومثوانا, أي تعلم ما ننقلب إليه ومثوانا. مثوانا أي ما نصير إليه, how we're going to turn, how we're going to be tomorrow, and when we're going to end, where we going, what is going to be the abode of every one of us. والله يعلم متقلبكم ومثواكم. Therefore, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows everything, to help us and help and accept and admit the one who passed away in his rahmah. وأنت على كل شيء قدير. وأنت على كل شيء قدير comes here to glorify and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his attributes. So someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the most generous, and nothing can challenge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or be, you know, make Allah incapable to do whatever he wants to do subhanahu. Therefore, no sin can be big for Allah. So wa innaka ala kulli shay'in qadir, ya Allah, if you will to forgive all sins, will you have the power to do such a thing? Such a thing, therefore, forgive us. And then the hadith goes, قال وأنت على كل اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام والسنة ومن توفيته منا فتوفه عليهما. اللهم قال اللهم أحيه من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام والسنة، ومن توفيته منا فتوفه عليهما. And the most hadith that is mentioned saying almost the same wording, but there's difference in the end. قال اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان. Because the hadith قال اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام والسنة. Oh Allah, whoever you provide life among us, you give life. Ya Allah, grant him the favor to live in a state of Islam and following the guidance of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the best of the dua. Ya Allah, whoever you cause to die, فَتَوَفَّهُ عَلَيْهِمَا, cause them to die on Islam and Sunnah. The other hadith, he said, cause them to die on Iman. أخص, more specific. Because the Islam, in the appearance of one submitting, he live his life submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when he dies, everyone knows he's among, you know, in the hand of a Muslim. He's going to be, observe the ghusl of the way of the Islam, and then the kafan of the way of Islam, and then he's going to be buried in the way of Islam. And this is part of his Islam. But what about his heart? That's the iman. So if he dies in this image, he's good. But if he dies in this image and his heart is opposing the submission, the apparent submission, there's a problem. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will consider his iman in his heart. So that's why in the other hadith made it more specific. قَالَ وَتَوَفَّهُ عَلَى الْإِيمَانِ وَتَوَفَّهُ عَلَى الْإِيمَانِ وَهَذَا أَبْلَغُ وَهَذَا أَبْلَغُ. Because the iman, when he said, oh Allah, cause him to die on a state of iman, because the iman, it has then the certainty that this one is completely or truly submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ مَسْأَلَ, is here we have a question. قَالَ الدُّعَاءُ الْوَالِدُ عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَوْلَى بِالْمُحَافَظَةِ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الدُّعَاءِ غَيْرِ الْوَالِدِ وَإِنْ كَانَ الْأَمْرُ وَاسِعًا. So here an observation to really memorize and to observe all the time the dua of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم will be the best, because his adiyah صلى الله عليه وسلم are the most comprehensive, and the most direct and the most beneficial adiyah. But if someone will make any other dua, قَالَ فَالْأَمْرُ وَاسَى, is not restricted, is open, is vast. But what is the best is the best to someone to do the dua of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then قال اللهم اغفر لحي وذكر وأنت على اللهم من أحييته منا فأحي على الإسلام والسنة ومن توفيته منا فتوفه عليهما اللهم اغفر له وارحمه. Again اللهم اغفر له وارحمه, والله forgive him and shower him with your mercy. And here this is the more someone specifying and insisting in the dua. Hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, قال أخلصوا له الدعاء. أخلصوا له الدعاء. أخلصوا, it means like make the most sincere of the dua to the one who passed away. Therefore, you have to specify him with the dua, because the beginning part of the dua is about, you know, the whole Muslim, alive and dead. Allahumma man ahyaytahu minna, so whoever you grant him life among us, O Allah, make him to live in the way of Islam and the Sunnah, and whoever you cause him to die. So the dead person, he's in front of the imam and you're making the dua. This dua is general for everyone, including the imam and everyone who's praying. So when the Prophet ﷺ قَالَ أَخْلِصُوا لَهُ الدُّعَاءَ, make the most sincere dua to him, to the one or to her who's praying. That's the second part. قَالَ أَللَّهُمَّ اغْفِرْ لَهُ وَارْحَمْهُ. So the dhamir here going back to the dead person. And this is when they are, when she's a woman, قُلْ أَللَّهُمَّ اغْفِرْ لَهَا وَارْحَمْهَا. If they are two, اللَّهُمَّ اغْفِرْ لَهُمَا وَارْحَمُهُمَا. If they are more than that, you know, say اللَّهُمَّ اغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَارْحَمْهُمْ. So to specify here, so the dua يكون خالصا specific for the one who's in front and the one that this janazah, salat al-janazah is observed before him or in front of him. قال وارحمه وارحمه to be admitted in your رحمة يا الله وعافه واعف عنه وعافه واعف عنه. Al-Maghfirah, we said, is to cover and to be protected from the effect of the sin. So Al-Maghfirah is like to erase the traces of the sin. It's like it doesn't exist anymore. Al-Afu, عافه وعفو عنه. Al-Afu, التسامح والتجاوز. عن مخالفة الأموال is to forgive, just you know, erase, forgive. So it's more specific. The other one to cover. This one عفو, you know, is like someone, you know, they have a, you know, someone he pushed someone, and then the other person you look at them, told them go, that's fine. عفا, عفا is like he let it go. He doesn't even call to account or to think. Because al-maghfirah might come after, you know, argument and things, and then the other person need to give his excuses, said, yes, okay, I'll forgive you. But al-afu is like, subhanAllah, afa amma salaf. He'll give up everything. If even someone has a right in his hand that been taken away from him, he's like, he let it go. He said, that's fine, you can keep everything. That's the afu. So the afu is stronger, more specific than the maghfirah, if you can say. وَالْمُعَافَاتُ المعافات العافية is السلامه, to be at peace, to be secure, to be, you know, removed and away from any harm. So قال الله مغفر له وارحمه وعافه واعف عنه. So عافه, يا الله, keep him away from any harm. Which is here we are targeting something imminent that you're going to be faced, the question of Munkar wa Nakir, the situation that you're going to be facing in the grave. وَعَافِهِ وَعْفُ عَنْهُ يَا اللَّهِ. If he has anything as debts or things that he has dues not paid, salat, siyam, anything, أَعْفُ عَنْهُ, forgive him, يَا اللَّهِ, let it go. قال then اللهم اغفر له وارحمه وعافه واعف عنه وعافه واعف عنه واكرم نزله واكرم نزله واكرم نزله. النزل is like the place where the guest will live or dwell. النزل, the hotel is called نزل. And nuzul is the place where someone is going to be as a visitor, as a guest, as a guest. One nuzul is al-qira. Al-qira is what in honoring the guest, which is an obligation, and it is from the behavior and the conduct of the believer, is to provide for him, you know, like food, to provide for him the best, you know, thing possible to honor the guest. So ikram nuzula, his nuzul, he's going to be his abode as a guest. Who's going to be, you know, subhanAllah, welcoming him in this new life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ikram nuzula. And no one can make ikram as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a story, just as his good reminder. Someone, he buried his brother, and there's people around the grave making dua, and there's someone, a stranger, like a traveler. He attended, and he also making dua. The brother, after a few nights, he saw a dream. His brother talking to him. He said, you know, told him what happened, mashallah. He said, Allah forgive me. And he said, what did you do actually? What are the things? Because subhanAllah, when you say Allah forgave me, there's one specific thing who led to the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why multiplying and making effort, and do not neglect any action, because you don't know which action is going to be the cause of your forgiveness. So the one who passed away, he's saying to his brother in his dream, he said, because of a traveler dua, he was a monk around. He said, so when he woke up, he remembered that there's a stranger, there's someone, you know, he's not from the town. So he went to find this person to ask him, what dua did he do? He found him, I mean, not a big town. So he asked him, he said, MashaAllah, Jazakallah khair for attending the janazah of my brother and everything. Is there a specific dua that you made? He said, no, not really. He said, can you think? He said, except that I said this. So this is the dua, subhanAllah. And he's a Bedouin, so he's not like a person of knowledge, but they have that common sense. He said, Ya Allah, this man who just passed away, if he was still alive and came to me as a guest, I will honor him. I will honor him. You know, because this is one of the etiquette, this is how they live. I will give him this, I will give him, I will honor him the best of the honoring. And you are Akramul Akramin. Oh Allah, I mean me as a servant, if he was my guest, today I will honor him. He's in a situation, he cannot do anything. So Allah honor him. فَأَكْرِمْ نُزُولَهُ As in the hadith, فَأَكْرِمْ نُزُولَهُ For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, of course he's more generous than any of his servants. And وَهُوَ أَكْرَمُ الْأَكْرَمِينَ فَأَكْرَمَهُ So he honored the dead person. And what is the best of the welcoming is not to present a feast, is to forgive him. So he forgave him. For that's the hadith. So when you think of this, subhanAllah, you think, if you have a guest, someone knocked the door, you know, you didn't see him for a long time, you will be so happy to honor him, get him to your home. There's etiquette. Look, the etiquette of Ibrahim, alayhi salam. Etiquette Ibrahim, when he had the guest, the three angels, and he didn't know that. قال فراغ إلى أهله فجاء بعجل حنيذ. And the other one, آية قال بعجل سمين. حنيذ وسمين give you the etiquette, the great etiquette of Ibrahim in his great honoring of his guest. So he got the عجل, the baby cow. First سمين, big. Second, so when he looked, when he came out to look what he's going to offer to his guest, he didn't see like, oh, this one I need it, I'm going to sell it to get make money. He looking at the weakest one. No, he get the best one, Samin. Then qala hanid. Hanid is the way that it was cooked. He didn't boil it and cut it into pieces and take. No, he grilled it, hanid. Then قال فقربه إليهم. He took it. And Raga, he didn't want them to be bothered. Just he want to, you know, keep them busy talking and everything. And then Raga, he doesn't want to disturb them or to let them know that he's preparing anything. Raga. Ragawan is like the fox. So it's like tiptoeing. And then when he got it, قَرَّبَهُ إِلَيْهِمِ He put it in front of them. And he got it in front. It's like almost he going to cut pieces and give them to eat. And they say, قَالَ أَلَا تَأْكُلُوا Please eat. See, so this is Ibrahim alayhi salam. These are the etiquette of the honoring. So imagine if someone will come to you that you respect. Or even someone is a stranger. How are you going to honor him? That's how you make this dua. Say, Ya Allah, you know, akrim nuzula. Because we are the poorest and we are the people who are full of shortcoming and we're making a lot of sins, but as this action, as a believers and Muslim, we have that sense of hospitality. So imagine then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say, قَالَ وَعْفُهُ وَعَافِهِ وَعْفُ عَنْهُ وَأَكْرِمْ نُزُولَهُ وَأَكْرِمْ نُزُولَهُ قَالَ وَأَوْسِعْ وَأَوْسِعْ مُدْخَلَهُ وَأَوْسِعْ مُدْخَلَهُ أوسع المدخل, المدخل is the entrance. Make vast, open up, ya Allah, his entrance. Entrance where? In the grave. Now, we're passing to a dimension of unseen. Now, the grave, when we're talking about the عذاب القبر, the punishment in the grave and the life in the grave, all of it is a dimension. It's totally different realm. It's not the physical grave. Even though we have narration, things happen in the physical grave. But here when we're talking, for example, the grave will open and it becomes as far as someone can see and it will be all light for the believers. For those wal'iyadu billah ungrateful and disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the grave will crush their bones. Wal'iyadu billah, crush them. So you're asking for your brother or your sister who passed away, after ikram al-nuzul, qala wa awsa mudkhala. Wa awsa mudkhala. So open up on his grave, because something is tight. If someone, he opened his eyes and he find himself with such tightness, I mean, it's an imminent, death, just if someone will be alive. So, qala wa awsa mudkhalahu, wa awsa mudkhalahu, al-madkhalu wal-mudkhalu, both are in the same. So that's the place where you're going to be for Allah to open up his grave, to open up his grave. قَالَ وَغْسِلْهُ بِالْمَاءِ وَالثَّلْجِ وَالْبَرَدِ. We know there's the squeeze of the grave, and there's tadiq, there's two. There's one, everyone who's going to have it. Because the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when they buried Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, and the Prophet ﷺ told us, قَالَ ضَمَّةُ الْقَبْرِ. He said, if there's someone who was going to be spared from ضَمَّةُ الْقَبْرِ, لَكَانَ سَعَدْ. لَكَانَ سَعَدْ. ضَمَّةُ الْقَبْرِ is the hagend, like tightening. The grave will tighten up on the dead person. But the other that we're talking here is like يُضَيَّقُ عَلَيْهِ, to crush him, that's part of the punishment of the grave, because the effect of the believer that is open up. قَالَ فَيَكُونُ عَلَى مَدَى بَصَرِهِ, and then he will be looking as his place in Jannah. نَسَى اللَّهَ أَنْ يَرْزُقَنَا وَإِيَّكُمْ هَذَا النَّعِيمِ يَا رَبِّ. So, ضَمَّةُ الْقَبْرِ, that it goes to everyone. This one has different meaning. ضَمَّةُ الْقَبْرِ. Everyone, believer and non-believer, he going to have this dhammat al-qabr. Dhammat al-qabri is the squeeze of the grave for the believer, is like a tight hug from the mother. You see, when someone, the mother, he missed her child, and she meets her child after a long time, it will, hug her child very tightly. Because the earth is the mother of your body, so it's going to tight, hug you. You did good on top of the earth. You did a lot of sujood. The other one will be tightening, wal'iyadu billah, like crushing the bone. So that's how the scholar, they mentioned that the squeeze of the grave, it is, it's not the same for the believer and non-believer, but everyone is going to go through the dhammat al-qabr. Then qala, وأوسع مدخله واغسله بالماء والثلج والبرد ونقه من الذنوب والخطايا كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. And here also is a figure of speech, to be washed. So we had washed it physically, the body was washed physically. Now the washing that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned in this hadith is the washing of the sins. And as the washing of the body and the clothes and the washing of the impurity is done by the water, is done by the snow, because the snow also can be used to make wudu, and the hail, which is you know, also water. So those are used the most pure, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً طَهُورًا. So the water not only is it pure, but it purifies. It purifies. And those are substance whose origin is water. So ma, the water and the snow and the hail, all of them. قَالَ وَخْسِلْهُ بِالْمَاءِ وَالثَّرْجِ وَالْبَرَدِ. You know, so washing. Yeah. And the washing here, we're talking about the washing of the sins. The washing of the sins. قَالَ وَالثَّرْجِ وَالْبَرَدِ وَنَقِّهِ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ وَالْخَطَايَ كَمَا يُنَقَّى الثَّوْبُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الدَّنَسِ. And the beautiful parable here, to have that, you know, focus in your dua and more sincere. Imagine a white garment and being dipped in, for example, or thrown in mud. How are you going to clean it? So you don't see in this white cloth garment, you see like traces of white, because the color is covered with this mud or with this, you know, filth. So when you clean it till it become white, so it becomes like full detail into cleaning, that we careless like yunaqi. Yunaqi is like to cleanse thoroughly. So that's the meaning. قَالَ وَنَقِّهِ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ. Just cleanse him completely from his sins, as the white garment is cleansed from the filth and from the impurity. كَمَا يُنَقَّى الثَّوْبُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الدَّنَسِ. And the hadith, وَنَقِّهِ مِنَ الْخَطَايَا. مِنَ الْخَطَايَا. وَنَقِّهِ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ وَالْخَطَايَا كَمَا يُنَقَّى الثَّوْبُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الدَّنَسِ وَأَبْدِلْهُ دَارًا خَيْرًا مِنْ دَارِهِ. وَأَبْدِلْهُ and replace him, يَرَى. The home that he left, because when someone is traveling, for example, he always has his longing to his back home, to his own home, to his family, right? That's why when he's coming back the for a long travel, people, they'll be longing back to their home. Longing back their home, longing back to their beds, longing back to all of that, because it's filled with their memory, filled with their thing of place of rest. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qal, وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا. He made out of your homes place of tranquility, of rest. So if someone leaving that place of tranquility on earth, the dua, Ya Allah, replace him with a better place of tranquility. دَارًا خَيْرًا مِنْ دَارِ. He's going to be the Jannah. Because that's when someone, the most hurting thing, that he's leaving the place where he used to dwell, where he used to have his rest, his tranquility, his family, his child. So to not have that bitterness for someone who is departing, he's going to find better than that. قَالَ وَزَوْجًا خَيْرًا مِنْ زَوْجِهِ. وَزَوْجًا خَيْرًا مِنْ زَوْجِهِ. And a spouse better than his spouse. Here, there's a saying among the scholar about this, and there's also ziyada. Say zawjan and specify for the woman, say ahlan khayran min ahli, or ahlan khayran min ahliha, or ahlan khayran min ahliha. La ilaha illallah. In the replacing or have him, some of the scholars specifying, which is a nice way to explain it, is here the sifa, the attribute, the quality of the spouses, which is mean here, you know, most of the scholars, they say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant the man, you know, one of the hur'een. But the question here is the woman, for interpret, for example, for the man, the woman of the dunya, the believer woman, is better, or the hur? We know that the believing woman is better than the hur. I mean, in all the perspective, beauty and everything, that because everyone going to be recreating, men and women. So here, the scholar, they said, because those who live together, they're going to be, so it's going to be better for him and it's going to be better for her from the point of view of akhlaq, from the point of view of beauty, from the point of view of everything. So it depends, because someone, for example, they will be together, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put them together. And this is one of the sunnah, you know. But if someone, for example, is, if the person that not the right person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always will grant him the better. So it doesn't mean also when someone is saying he's departing, a man or a woman, that in the next life they already disconnect from the people who left in the behind. That's what we want to specify here. So khayran, al-khayriya, to the better, is in the moral, in the akhlaq, in the thing, because whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in Jannah are not better from those who are believers, because the believer, they will be recreated. And the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when that old woman came to the Prophet ﷺ, she said, can an old woman enter paradise? You know, the Prophet ﷺ said, no old woman enter paradise. So she went crying. And then he called her. He was told her, come back. I said, no old woman enter paradise, because everyone will be recreated to be in paradise at the age of 33. So no old woman enter paradise. The old woman, she's going to be young. She's going to be young. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna ansha'nahunna insha'a. Allah recreate them. Alhamdulillah. Qala wa adkhilhu, and then wa ahlan khayran min ahlihi. وأبدله وزوجا خيرا من زوجه وأدخله الجنة وأدخله. That's the greatest of the thing. Allah grant him, make him to enter paradise. وأعذه من عذاب القبر وعذاب النار. And أعذه, you know, yeah, Allah shield him and remove him away from the punishment of the grave and the punishment of the hellfire. And here, this part of the hadith, you say someone will ask you, if you ask Allah to grant him paradise, so by granting paradise, he might be saved from the punishment of the grave and punishment from the hellfire. We say no, because there's people who enter paradise, they're going to suffer both punishment. Because there's two types of getting to paradise, at the day of judgment, right after the day of judgment, there's people that get to paradise after being punished in hellfire or hellfire. And there's people who get to paradise after being punished in the grave. So it depends on someone's, record he has. So here when we say, it's like bara'a min kul shay, oh Allah, grant him paradise and remove him from وَأَعِذْهُ, Ya Allah, make him to not be or to not have inflicted on him the punishment of the grave and the punishment of the hellfire. قَالَ وَفْسَحْ 71 وَفْسَحْ لَهُ فِي قَبْرِهِ وَنَوِّرْ لَهُ فِيهِ وَفْسَحْ, and this is the opposite of ضَيَّقْ. So that's, from the sunnah and from the ancient al-ghaybu, that the grave can be, a garden of bliss, or can be hufra, a pit of higher wal-iyadu billah. وَأَعِذْهُ قَال وَفْسَحْ لَهُ فِي قَبْرِهِ أي وَسَّعْ لَهُ, أي وَسَّعْ لَهُ, as we said. وَنَوَّلْ لَهُ فِيهِ أي اجْعَلْ لَهُ فِيهِ نُورًا, oh Allah, make to be filled with light his qabr. His qabr. Any question? So this is after the third takbirah. This is after the third takbirah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. So again, we just read the hadith that we explained, or the dua. the whole dua قال ويدعو في الثالثة, so at the last the third takbira, فيقول اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا إنك تعلم منقلبنا ومثوانا وأنت على كل شيء قدير. اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام والسنة ومن توفيته منا فتوفه عليهما. اللهم اغفر له وارحمه. So this part it will be specific for the one who passed away. اللهم اغفر له وارحمه وعافه واعف عنه وأكرم نزله وأوسع مدخله واغسله بالماء والثلج والبرد ونقه من الذنوب والخطايا كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس وأبدله دارا خيرا من داره وزوجا خيرا من زوجه وأدخله الجنة وأعذه من عذاب القبر وعذاب النار وافسح اللهم وافسح له في قبره ونور له فيه ونور له فيه. طيب قال في الروض another book also that had the شرح of زاد المستقنع قال ولا بأس بالإشارة بالأصبع حال الدعاء للميت. You know when you make the dua in the tashahhud you point, so it's also permissible to do the same, you know, pointing, because the dua when you make in the sign, that's where the Prophet ﷺ said you do it in the tashahhud for the dua. He said there is no objective someone to do such a thing. وَإِنْ كَانَ صَغِيرًا. Now if the deceased person is a child, the child is more not a mukallaf, he's not mukallaf, which is mean like he's not accountable because his record didn't start to be, you know, being observed and written on it, the good and the bad, what he's doing. Yeah. وَإِنْ كَانَ صَغِيرًا, if his parents are Muslim and he's born and then grew up in Islam and he died young, so the dua will be different, because when you say اللهم اغفر له, he didn't do sins really. قَالَ so the siga here, قال, لم يثبت, but for the young one, for the child, we don't have a specific dua said by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم or evidence to tell us exactly what was the dua. But this dua, this formula of the way of this dua, is really being praised and accepted by the scholar رحمهم الله تعالى. So the dua to say قال وإن كان صغيرا قال اللهم اجعله ذخرا لوالديه. اللهم اجعله ذخرا لوالديه. وإن كان صغيرا, if he's young, for Allah make him to be ذخرا لوالديه. ذخرا is like something that, you know, when you store something good that you're going to use it in the future, is going to help you. That's kind of what is the ذخر. So a young child, when he died, oh Allah make him to be dhukhr. Dhukhr is going to be, they're going to be hurt, but he's going to benefit them in the next life. Something they're going to be saved. Dhukhr is the saving. Yeah, saving. لوالدي. أي أنها مصدر بمعنى المفعول أي مذخورا لوالدي يرجعان إليه عند الحاجة. So they're going to need him. Because subhanAllah, you know, in the hadith, when someone who lose a young child and will be patient and make hamd, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala build for the parents, you know, the bayt ismu al-hamd, bayt ismu al-hamd, a house called the house of hamd. قال ذخرا لوالديه, because the patience that they have the parents, and being a young child, he going to be helping them in the day of judgment. In some of the narration, he will be in the land of resurrection, bringing them water when there is no water. قال وفرطا. قال وفرطا. وفرطا, the meaning of the فرطا, that سابقا. سابقا is going to be there waiting for them. سبقهم, he advanced them to be there. وفرطا. وفرط. So فرط, even in the day of judgment, he will be like subhanAllah, will be walking in front of them. And he's waiting for them. He's before them. So imagine someone has already, someone who advanced from the family, he's being showered by the mercy of Allah because young, so he's waiting there to be like granted the same favor of the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَجْرًا أَيْ اِجْعَلْهُ لَهُمَا أَجْرًا, and make it to be for them a reward. As he died young, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower them and give them reward for their patience and for this how been inflicted with big difficulties. So it's been taken away, it's going to be a reward for them. وَشَفِيعًا, شَفِيعًا ذُخْرًا لِوَالِدَيْهِ وَفَرَةً وَأَجْرًا وَشَفِيعًا مُجَابًا. So Allah make him also to intercede for his parents. An intercession that will be accepted. That's why مُجَابًا, شَفِيعًا مُجَابًا. اللهم ثقل به موازينهما, اللهم ثقل به موازينهما. Oh Allah, ثقل from, you know, put more weight, increase the weight of their balance of good deeds by him, by the child who passed away. ثقل به موازينهما. وأعظم به أجورهما, وأعظم به أجورهما, at the same, and make tremendous their أجر, their أجر, their reward by losing the their child. ونحن والميزان, we studied in the عقيدة, we studied the ميزان in the عقيدة, so we don't want to get into details of the ميزان as the شارح did. وأعظم به أجورهما, make to be, as we said, the أجر, the reward to be tremendous. قال وألحقه, وأعظم به أجورهما, وألحقه بصالح سلف المؤمنين, وألحقه بصالح سلف المؤمنين, and join him, ya Allah, with the righteous of those believers who passed away. وجعله في كفالة إبراهيم, وجعله في كفالة إبراهيم, and made him, ya Allah, to be under the guardianship of Ibrahim. Under the guardianship of Ibrahim. And this is, there is a story related to this dua, which is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his ascension to beyond the seventh heaven, he met Ibrahim alayhi salam by al-bayt al-ma'mur. And Ibrahim is being told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he had children with him, teaching them Quran. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was told, قال هؤلاء ولدان المؤمنين. These are the children of the believers who passed away young. That's why قال واجعله في كفالة إبراهيم, make their guardianship to Ibrahim, so he will be taking care of them, عليه السلام. وقه برحمتك عذاب الجحيم, and shield him, ya Allah, by your rahmah from the doom of the fire, والعياذ بالله. وقه برحمتك عذاب الجحيم, because everyone is gonna cross the sirat over the hellfire, even the children. So it will be also dua to be shielded from such, you know, difficulty. قال ويقف بعد الرابعة قليلا, ويقف بعد الرابعة قليلا, ويقف بعد الرابعة قليلا, ويسلم واحدة عن يمينه. And then he stop after the fourth takbirah. He say Allahu Akbar. Keep a moment of silence. And then قال ويسلم ويقف بعد الرابعة قليلا ويسلم واحدة. And he make one taslim. Say السلام عليكم one time. Say السلام عليكم one time. According to the author, after the fourth takbirah, so he will not say anything. And to not confuse the ma'mumin and to not mix between the takbirah and the taslim, so he will take some time, moments to say, Allahu Akbar, stop, and say, Assalamu alaykum. Okay? So here, according to the author, he will not say anything. According to the author. But if someone will say a dua also after the fourth takbirah, that's good, because there's a narration, قَالَ وَاخْتَارَ بَعْضُ الْأَصْحَابِ, some of the scholars from the school of thought of the author, the Hanbali school of thought, أَنَّهُ يَدْعُ بِقَوْلِهِ اللَّهُمَّ لَا تَحْرِمْنَا أَجْرَهُ وَلَا تَفْتِنَّ بَعْدَهُ وَاغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلَهُ. The short dua. Allahumma la tahrimna ajra, wa Allah do not deprive them from the reward that you've given him, and do not cause us to be in fitna and go astray after his death, and forgive us and forgive him. Other scholars, they said in that short time you'll say Rabbana atina fid dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. And the Prophet ﷺ made this dua to be the end of the dua, as in every end of tawaf, if every one round, after Rukn al-Yamani, he said, رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا فِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا قِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Is like, and then he get to Hajar al-Aswad and he start. So the last dua in the tawaf is, رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا فِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا قِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And this is also in the end of the manasik. So it will be like a dua to end with, رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا فِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا قِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ, as some of the scholars, they said. And وَالْأَمْرُ وَاسَى. It's either to keep silent or to say dua, and this dua that been mentioned, or say any other dua. قال ويسلم واحدة عن يمينه, and he will make taslim one time on his right side. But it's okay to do two, as he said. قال أنه لا بأس أن يسلم مرة ثانية. There's no objection if you say also السلام عليكم, like we do in the prayer. And those who said they make only one taslima, they have an evidence, but this evidence is not as strong hadith to rely on. But we have in the salat that you make two times. And whoever who make one time, that's of course is as the author is describing. But if someone will do the second time, there's no objection and no blame on the person who does two times the taslima. Now. ويقف بعد الرابعة قليلا ويسلم واحدة عن يمينه ويرفع يديه مع كل تكبيرة. So this is now getting into some of the specification of the salah. He said he will lift his hands at every takbirah. So we say Allahu Akbar the first time. Then the rest of the three also the same thing, to lift the hands. Every time Allahu Akbar, the first time Al-Fatiha. Allahu Akbar, the second one, after it is As-Salatul Ibrahimiyya. Allahu Akbar, after that, third one is the dua. Allahu Akbar, small, short, silent, and say salam. Or you say Allahumma, as he said here, you know, لا تحرمنا أجرا ولا تفتنا بعده واغفر لنا ولها. Or ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. And then the taslim. قال ويرفع يديه مع كل تكبيرة ويرفع يديه مع كل تكبيرة. Then we try to finish this inshallah. We'll give you the break at 7. وواجباتها. So now, what are the pillar of this prayer? What are the pillar of this prayer? So So the requirement of the salah is to stand. وواجباتها قيام وتكبيرات. So the pillar of the prayer, the required in the prayer, the stand and the four takbirat. That's the heart of it. قيام أي واجب إذا كانت فريضة. And then the four takbirat, so the arkan, the pillars of Salatul Janazah, the standing and the four takbirat. قال وواجباتها قيام وتكبيرات. والفاتحة والصلاة على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ودعوة للميت والسلام. So all of that are, but the فاتحة, for those who are saying the Fatiha also in the other prayer is rukun, then is rukun in Janazah. And those who are saying that the Salat on the Prophet ﷺ is also a pillar in from among the scholars, is also pillar here. But those who say it's not pillar, then it's not a pillar. أربع تكبيرات is the minimum, because it's been narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال صلى على جنازة فكبر عليها خمسة. He made the janazah, he prayed janazah, and he make five takbirat. So to make five, six, seven, there is no objection. If it's needed or if you see someone doing it because that's not forbidden. But the minimum is four. The minimum is four. The Fatiha, as we said, then As-Salatu ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is from the obligatory part, but not pillar. So if someone will not say it, will not invalidate the prayer. But it is in the etiquette of the dua, because the best of the dua, that you start with the praising Allah, and then sending the blessing on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the peace and blessing upon our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the dua. So the dua, it has more likely to be heard and accepted if you do in this etiquette, and to precede the dua by the salat on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then qala wa da'watun al-mayyit, wa da'watun lil-mayyiti. قال as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا صليتم على الميت فأخلصوا له الدعاء. If you pray on the mayit, so be sincere and make a dua, sincere dua to him. Then make sincere dua to him. قال ودعوة للميت and والسلام. And the salam is, that's the way how to finish the prayer. That's the way how to finish prayer. The other rukun is the sequence, to follow the sequence. وَالتَّرْتِيبُ أَرْكَانُ صَلَاتُ الْجَنَازَةِ is to make like the first takbirat with the fatiha first, and then and so on. That's those are the pillar of the prayer, as we mentioned. And you said, قَالَ وَوَاجِبَاتُهَا قِيَامٌ. So it's obligatory part or arkan, standing, then takbirat, then surat al-fatiha, then the salat on the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then the dua for the mayyit, then the salam. وَمَنْ فَاتَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنَ التَّكْبِيرِ قَضَاهُ عَلَى صِفَتِهِ. وَمَنْ فَاتَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنَ التَّكْبِيرِ قَضَاهُ عَلَى صِفَتِهِ. Whoever who come late, do you have any question up to here, sir? The one who attend the janazah, they already start, the imam start the first takbir. And then he's in second takbir and someone join. He said, وَمَنْ فَاتَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنَ التَّكْبِيرِ قَضَاهُ عَلَى صِفَتِهِ. So this is, we're going to apply the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, saying, when you join, you finish with them, and then whatever you have missed, you finish it on your own. وَمَنْ فَاتَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنَ التَّكْبِيرِ قَضَاهُ عَلَى صِفَتِهِ. Here, does he have the condition? قال وَمَنْ فَاتَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنَ التَّكْبِيرِ. طيب. We'll give more details here. وَقِيلَ يَقْضِيهَا عَلَى صِفَتِهَا مَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُوا. This is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, قال whatever you مَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا. You pray with the imam when you join him, and whatever you missed, you make it on your own. Make it on your own. The way how to be done is as the here, if he has mentioned this here. Qala, if someone come to the Imam in the third takbirah, should he recite the Fatiha and make the dua, because that's the time of the dua? The answer he's saying here, most likely he should make the dua for the mayit, because the Imam is making the dua, he'll make the dua. فَيَنْبَغِي فِي صَلَةٍ أَنْ يُتَابِعَ الْإِمَامِ فِي مَا هُوَ فِيهِ. So in Salat al-Janaza, he has to follow exactly what the Imam is doing, because you know what the Imam is doing. The other Salat, when you come, you pray, the Imam is reciting only Fatiha, you can recite Fatiha and Surah. Why? Because when the Imam finish, you're going to continue the prayer. So if the Imam at the third rak'ah in Asr time, you join him, that third rak'ah is going to be for the jami'ah, for you is going to be the first rak'ah. So when the Imam finish, you stand up to make your third rak'ah, because you only pray two rak'ah. And this is one of the way how to finish your prayer when someone joined the Imam late. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam qala in the hadith, ma adraktum fasallu wa ma fatakum fa'atimmu. Fa'atimmu, atimmu is like finish what you have missed. So finish is like atimmu. So the third, when you Imam make his taslim and it was your second rak'ah, when you stand up, it's going to be your third rak'ah. So in the third rak'ah, you're only going to recite a surah. So here is kind of different. We are taking one approach, which is to al-qadha. You will make up what you have missed. Why? Because you should be following what the Imam is doing. Because at the third takbirah, the Imam is doing dua, so you make dua. And then when the Imam says Assalamu alaikum, thus you make another. So you have two takbirah with the Imam, you have the rest two takbirah, you make the Fatiha, and you make the Salat on the Prophet to finish the rest of the takbirah, because four takbirat are a pillar, someone has to finish it. Some of the scholars, they said he will finish with the Imam as long as the janazah was not taken away, because the body, if they lift it and take away, therefore you cannot make the salah. So because the salat need to be done in front of the deceased person, which is bring us to three way how to do it, three opinion. If someone came late, we have the first case that he will make up what he missed. He will make up what he missed before they move away the janazah. Okay, because the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ma fatakum fa'atim," what you have missed, you do it after the Imam finish. But here we have the restriction, as long as the body is in its place. The second case, he will be concerned if they're going to move it, so he's going to hasten to do the takbirat. He said he should do it fast, even though he's going to make like very short dua for them. The third case is to stop with the Imam. When the Imam says Assalamu alaikum, he'll make Assalamu alaikum. Why? Because remember, this is fard kifayah. So the fard, the obligation to pray on the mayit, was fulfilled by the taslim of the Imam. When the Imam says Assalamu alaikum, then it's been already fulfilled. So say he will finish with the Imam and he doesn't have to do the rest. So these are the three cases. Now, for someone who didn't attend the prayer at all, what will be the case? This is someone who joined, they are there, he started to finish with them. If the Imam, we said, say Assalamu alaikum, salam, and they took the janazah, he will hasten to follow them. If they say Assalamu alaikum and he's still there sometime, he finished the two other takbirat or whatever he have missed. Wada. So this is the question here, as long as the body there, he can finish. In the body, if he's moved, he will either hasten or stop. And these are the difference. Now, قَالَ وَمَنْ فَاتَتْهُ الصَّلَاةُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّ عَلَى الْقَبْرِ وَمَنْ فَاتَتْهُ الصَّلَاةُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّ عَلَى الْقَبْرِ وَمَنْ فَاتَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنَ التَّكْبِيرِ قَضَاهُ عَلَى صِفَتِهِ Whoever who missed some of the takbirat, he will make it up the way how he missed it. Then, وَمَنْ فَاتَتْهُ الصَّلَاةُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّ عَلَى الْقَبْرِ Or whoever who missed the salat, he will pray janaza by himself on the grave, by the grave. By the grave. Well, it depends. Here the opinion, in the opinion of the school of thought of the author, that they related to the or restricted to the presence of the body, which the other opinion they do not. Therefore, when you look at the other opinion, you find that he will finish the prayer. He will finish the prayer. So it's not related to the presence of the body. Well, that's the thing. If we follow the hadith of the Prophet, the Imam, while he's making dua, the one who joined, he's gonna be making the Fatiha. And then he makes the salah, and then he'll do it on his own, but he's following the Imam in takbirat. But according to the sharh here, he said, while the Imam is doing the dua, in this case, you know what he's doing. You know, he's not like reciting. So you know that. So you follow him, you make the dua. Because that's the time, that's the heart of the whole salat is the dua. So you join the dua with them. And then you finish the takbirat, so you make the qadha. So after making the dua, it's like also there's the opinion in the other hadith, قَالَ وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَقْضُ So for example, someone, he joined the imam in the two last rak'ah. He's going to pray fatiha, right? Now, the third rak'ah that he's going to pray on his own, for him, in certain opinion, based on the other narration of the hadith, and mainly like the Maliki school, they start that the third rak'ah for him is going to be the first rak'ah. So he's going to pray, recite Fatiha and Surah. So he finished with the Imam, and then he make up what he missed. So here he's going to enter with the Imam, make the dua, and then when the Imam finish, he has two takbirat he has to finish. So he'll make the two takbirat by qadha. He missed the Fatiha and he missed Salat al-Nabi Salasa. And here the whole question here is about the presence of the janazah. That's why according to some of the scholar here, as he's saying, he say as long as the janazah was not taken away. That's why if someone make the taslim with the imam and he will not finish, he will have the whole ajr, inshaAllah. Because this salat is fardu kifayah. It's not like fard ayn. Because you join, for example, salat al-dhuhr, he said, alhamdulillah, the imam, he prayed it, so I will make taslim with them. But I don't know, you have to pray what you have missed because nobody can replace your own prayer. For salat al-janazah, if he didn't even attend, it's been already fulfilled. So the taslim of the imam, when the imam says, assalamu alaikum, that obligation been fulfilled. Because with the presence of the imam and the ma'mumin with him. The one who missed the prayer, he will, and he wished to offer the prayer on the deceased person, which has happened. People, for example, you know, they live far and they heard, you know, a deer that he passed away, and coming back traveling, he would not be able to attend the janazah, and the person was already buried. So where, how to do it? He'll go to the grave, face the qibla, put the grave between him and the qibla, and he pray salatul janazah. He prays salatul janazah. That's what the meaning. وَمَنْ فَاتَتْهُ الصَّلَاةُ عليه صلى على القبر ومن فاتته الصلاة قال صلى على القبر. So the one who missed completing the prayer, he can pray on the grave, by the grave. The evidence of this is the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. There were a lady who used to clean the masjid. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he missed her. He said, where so and so? He told him, Ya Rasulullah, she passed away. He told him, you didn't tell me. She said, it was night. So we buried her, we washed her and we buried her. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was like angry. قال أخبروه أنها فقال هل لا كنتم آذنتموني. Why you didn't take my permission? Why you didn't tell me? It's like, you know, the surrounding, you know, she wasn't like known. She like volunteered to clean the masjid. فقال دلوني على قبرها. So show me her grave. فخرج بنفسه عليه الصلاة والسلام وصلى على قبرها. He left and he went to her grave and he offered the prayer of janazah by her grave, صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the same, if it was a man, he stand by the side of the head because there will be like, you know, kind of sign to know where the head is. And if a woman, he will stand in the middle. So it's going to be the same thing. Saying here, if someone kind of questioned, someone fell in a well and they could not get him out. So they said, they block the well and they pray by the well, becomes like the grave of the person in case they cannot get him out. So the well will become his grave. So they block the well and then they offer the prayer by the well. The وَعَلَى غَائِبٍ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Someone who passed away overseas or in different place, can we pray on this person? Qala, look what he said here, what we call Salatul Ghaib. وَعَلَى غَائِبٍ عَنِ الْبَلَدِ بِالنِّيَّةِ إِلَى شَهْرٍ. Someone who's traveling and he died out of town, or someone known and he's died out of town, or like he died in another place. Someone can pray with condition on that person, Salatul Janazah, with the intention for a whole month. So like a month after his death, a month after his death. طيب. But really the month, it's not very specified. You know, there is no tahdeed in the sunnah to say only a month. Okay. The opinion, I mean, as we don't have restriction, we cannot restrict, so we don't have a dalil. So there's no dalil to say after a month. As long as this person, no one offered prayer janazah on him, the janazah prayer can be offered even after years. So this is the saying of the scholar, rahimahullah ta'ala. The hadith, they said, you know, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إلى شهر, that the Prophet قال صلى على قبر إلى شهر, that because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he prayed on a grave after a month. But after a month, they didn't mean like the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, you know, in his action that he restricted up to month. It happened that he knew or they come to that place after a month of the death of this person. So if the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came afterward, would he have prayed or not? He would, because he didn't tell us, do not pray on a person if he didn't pray on it after a month on his grave. No. So he's open.
The
one, does any person who passed, who died, and no one from, you know, in different country or different place, can the janazah be offered on him in his absence? Like in absence of the body? In absence of the janazah? There's difference of opinion here, okay? There's difference of opinion. The first opinion, and the opinion this is shared, and some of the scholars, they say this is a bid'ah. They say to pray on everyone, you know, absent, you know, غائب, he's not there. Even thousands of Muslims, they prayed and they offer the janazah on him, you can pray on him too. So people, for example, some deal at back home, he passed away, and they offer the janazah, and they people, he asked people to pray janazah on him to also. That's, you know, or to do it for everyone who died from the Muslim. This is not, there's no evidence to do such a thing. There's no, because the salat is the ibadah, and ibadah required to be observe all its condition and all its etiquette and all its wajibat. The second opinion, they said, al-ghaibu, the one who's not present, and to pray janazah on him, you know, if he's someone known among the Muslim with his benefit, with his, for example, a scholar, someone who's been like generous with the community, someone who's known with his good and righteousness. So these people say, you know, when people they do salat on him, is like encouraging and inspiring everyone that someone should be like this person. So this is kind of a middle opinion. And some, many of the scholars, they adopting this opinion. Someone, for example, in the Muslim country, someone known with his piety, with his righteousness, with his knowledge, he has a lot of students, a lot of respect, So when he died, everyone who want to offer prayer on him or being done like that, like honoring this person, by honoring the knowledge, by honoring the hospitality, by honoring the generosity, so someone will be inspired to say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us like these people who passed away in their righteousness and piety. So this is the second opinion. The third opinion, which is the strongest opinion. There's no prayer on the one who is not present. I mean, his janazah is not present. Only if no prayer was offered on him where he died. Why? Because your relation with the deceased person is the dua. So you can make dua all the time. The prayer is a worship at the time of the janazah. But if someone passed away in a place, people that didn't know what to do, and there's no Muslim around them, and he died, and people, and they've been buried. So the Muslim or his people, when they hear about that, they offer salat or janazah. Why? Because no salat was offered on him. This is what was also the opinion defended and adopted by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And he's saying that salat al-janazah, or al-ibadah, it is a worship. And the ibadah cannot be legislated or approved only by the book and the sunnah. And from the seerah of the Prophet and the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, no prayer was done on anyone, you know, who wasn't present, his janazah is present. No prayer was done by the Prophet, except for one, which, who was the king An-Najashi, the king of Abyssinia and Najashi. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَالَ إِنَّهُ مَاتَ الْيَوْمَ عَبْدٌ صَالِحٌ. Today, a righteous man passed away. And in another narration, قال إن أخلكم قد مات. He said, a brother of yours today passed away. ثم أمرهم أن يخرجوا إلى المصلى. And then he ordered them to get out to the place where they offer صلاة الجنازة. Now the scholar they saying here that Al-Najashi, he died among people of the book and he was Muslim. Not many of them, they know that he accepted Islam. And he honored the companion who made the first hijrah to Habasha. And even there's believers around them, they don't know how to do it. So the justification here, the salat that the Prophet ﷺ did on the Al-Ghaib, on Al-Najashi, that no one had offered prayer for him. So this is the illa and the qiyas that we do. إلى شهر to a month, as we said, there is no restriction and there is no evidence on such a thing. Any question? طيب, we'll finish this and we'll give you, I'll give you the break, inshallah. قال here. ولا يصلي الإمام على الغالي ولا على قاتل نفسه. The Imam, he's the Imam here when you're talking, for example, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the one who's leading, the one who's known by, for example, in the governance, in the ruling, the one who's responsible into the town or in the country. The one who committed al-ghulul. Al-ghulul is to take part of the spoils of war with no permission. He's kind of ghalin, he's like took something that doesn't belong to him. And subhanAllah, the Imam, he doesn't pray on him. Why? The prayer of the Imam is an honoring. And the non-prayer, when the Imam, he refused to pray, it doesn't mean that no prayer is going to be offered. No, he's going to be offered by other, but not by the Imam. Because the Imam, he's like the let's say, the guide and the example. If he goes and honoring, so the Imam will be praying on a person. If a person, he has a problem, so the prayer of the Imam is like approving his problem, his defect, his shortcoming. So it's like, also is a nikaya. Nikaya is like his punishment. You did something, you don't deserve that the Imam will pray for you. We talk of the Imam who is the leader of the nation or things like that. Qala, hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tuwfiya rajulun min Juhayna yawma Khaybar, fadhukira dhalika li Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A man from Juhayna, he died on the day of Khaybar, on the battle of Khaybar. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was told, faqala sallu ala sahibikum. He said, go pray on your friend or sahibukum of your sahib. قالت فتغيرت وجوه القوم. Everyone was scared. The Prophet is refusing to pray on him. فلما رأى ما بهم, when he saw their concern and you know they were like frightened. قال إن صاحبكم غل في سبيل الله. He said, your friend of yours, your companion, he make غلول, غل في سبيل الله. He took something from the spoilers without permission. ففتشنا متاع. We open his you know load, what he has, you know, his bags or his load that he has. فوجدنا فيها خرزا من خرز اليهود. You find something like very small that he took from the people of the book, from the Jews. It doesn't even cost 2 dirham. I mean, few bucks, like we say. So the Prophet to refuse to pray on him because of what he took without permission. So it's not about the value, but about the violation and about, you know, the trust. You've been trusted things. This doesn't belong to you. Give it to those who have to handle it, and they give it back to you, it becomes to you halal. Or you give it to them and you say, can I get this? They give it to you because it doesn't cost anything. But to hide it into your bag or something, that was the wrong thing. قال سو الغلول أن الله سبحانه قال وما كان لنبي أن يغل ومن غل يأتي بما غل يوم القيامة ومن يغل يأتي بما غل in Surah Ali Imran. Whoever takes something which is not his, he's gonna come in the day of judgment holding what he took. So it's gonna be evidence and proof against him. The second one, that the imam will not observe his prayer and lead his prayer, is the one who commits suicide. The evidence of that the Prophet said, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أتى أتي برجل قد قتل نفسه بمشاقص. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, they brought him a man who killed himself with مشاقص. مشاقص is kind, مشقص is like spear, long. They used to use it to hunt animals. Like a spear with a long blade. He killed himself with that. فَلَمْ يُصَلِّ عَلَيْهِ. He didn't pray on him. But the rest of the people, they pray, because committing suicide does not make someone out of Islam. So it's one of the major sin, and it might be major sin, وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, that someone will be punished seriously and grievously, with a grievous penalty, وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, in the hellfire. The question here is, anyone who will be doing a thing like atrocity or like a violation, like al-ghulul or suicide, also will be deprived from the imam prayer? Some of the scholars say we have this as a restriction because we have the dalil, we don't extend it, but the rest of the scholars, they said yes. Because when you see at the moral and the spirit of the action, is not to encourage anyone, so is that to reprimand everyone who will be attending such a thing, because kind of a disgrace. He did this? No. Okay, he's going to be treated as a Muslim, but he's not going to be honored, the full honoring, because he killed himself. So anyone who does such a thing, a robber who, you know, who hurting Muslim, who doing this, who stealing, and they known by that, the imam, he should not. Wallahu ta'ala. The last thing here, what he said here, a question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whoever who kill, a believer, and someone killing himself will be the same thing. Qala, he will be in hellfire forever. So being in hellfire forever, it means that he's not a believer. So how can the prayer will be offered on someone who commits suicide? Here the difference is subtle. The one who will be forever in hellfire, the one who make the killing to be halal, therefore he's not a believer anymore. قَالَ وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا. Intentionally, he's like, he believed that killing this person is fine. To believe that killing is okay, is permissible, that's negate the deen. Because that's why al-ulama, they asked, one of the questions being asked to al-imam Ahmed, قَالَ فَضَحِكْ. He laughed. قَالَ وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ إِذَا اسْتَحَلَّ الْقَتْلَ فَهَوَ كَافِرٌ سَوَى قَتَلْ أَوْ لَمْ يُقْتَلْ. So the one who he believed that killing is permissible, he is non-believer, is either he kill or doesn't kill. So the fact that he believing that, he's not a believer. So if he kill, therefore he going to have the major sin of killing on foundation of non-belief, he will be وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ in the hellfire. The last one, قَالَ وَلَا بَأْسَ بِالصَّلَاةِ عَلَيْهِ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ. And there's no objection if the janazah will be offered in the masjid. Why? Because some of the scholars, they say it is disliked. So the janazah is offered, in a convenient place, is either placed by the graveyard before they make some musalla close to the graveyard to offer the prayer of the janazah. And the Prophet ﷺ, he has a musalla, he has a place for the Salat al-Janazah, which wasn't in the Musalla. But if, you know, also because we have a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ and the Nabiya salla ala sahlin ibn Bayda'a fil masjid, that the Prophet ﷺ, he observed the prayer of companion named Sahl ibn Bayda'a in the masjid, which is make that if someone will pray in the masjid Salat al-Janazah, there is no objection for that, but they recommended to be in a place specific for the Janazah. We stop here, inshallah ta'ala, for the finishing this chapter. And next chapter is going to be short, which is how to carry the janazah and how to get the body into the grave. And this is also from Babul Faqhi. And I think the next page will be starting the book of Zakat, right? And the book of Zakat, inshallah, will be starting. We wish to go faster, huh? Yeah. Taib. Okay. Yes, here he is. Taib. We'll try to, inshallah, if we can start the class of the book of Zakat next time, inshallah. Oh, actually, next time we're not going to have... Next Sunday, we're going to have the intensive learning. All of you are going to be, inshallah, in the intensive learning. So we're going to have a pause for next time, inshallah. So, which is reminding you that we're going to have, it's going to be intensive, Dawra Ilmiya, starting on Saturday the 12th, right? That's the 12th Saturday, and it goes for a whole week. Everyone is invited, mashallah. We're going to have, for many of you, it's going to be refreshing and reviewing, which is good, from different books. And maybe one, actually, we didn't study it in the Ma'ad, is Usul al-Tafsir, so it's going to be good. And the preparation for the science of Qur'an that we're going to study in this program, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to study four books. The first book is the introduction of Risalat Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, a concise, beautiful one in the Aqidah, which is going to be refreshing and reviewing all the matters of the Aqidah. The second book is in Usul al-Tafsir, Hashiya ala Usul al-Tafsir Ibn al-Qasim, and is also going through understanding everything related to the Tafsir and the condition, the fundamental of the Tafsir. The third book is also, for many of you, is going to be a review of the Mustalah al-Hadith, the terminology of the Hadith, concise book of Al-Bayquniyya. So that's also is a good one. For the rest, especially for the youth or for a student of knowledge new, is going to help them, especially for the youth. And this is, you know, to pass the word, is going to be like that build the basis so they can join the Ma'had. Because some people, when they join the Ma'had, they find it advanced. This Dawra will help. That's why is the university will be also the one who attend. Inshallah, we're going to have type of the certification, kind of the ijazat, but for those who attend, and attend this with assignment. So the assignment for those who want to get credit, and then will be like also kind of prerequisite for the Ma'ad, especially for those who never had studied in the university. It will be helping them, inshallah, to access and to be resisting in the Ma'ad. That's right. Inshallah ta'ala. For next week, we'll be all together. At least if you cannot come the rest of the days, our Ma'had will be there, inshallah. So if you have any question that related to our classes, it can be also done in the session that we're going to have. So the next week, Ma'had will be at the Musalla, but within the books that we're going to be studying, inshallah ta'ala. I will try maybe to stream it for those who cannot attend the rest of the week. At least they can benefit, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, from the sermon, inshallah ta'ala. Any question? The books, that's what we were going to talk about. The books, we're going to have them for download, printing it. It's up to you, so we can have it. We can print some, and also the idea, if it be possible, to have them, inshallah, also on screen. So we can go line by line, and we have it on screen. Maybe that's an idea that we can work on it, inshallah. But heaven for student of knowledge, to have the book like you have it, it will be good. Or to have it on your device, you know, also, so we'll have it available for download. We can share it on Facebook, and maybe also have it on the Masjid website or things like that, inshallah. Okay. I'll get you to the break and meet you in half an hour, inshallah.
Jazakallah.